This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland. You've reached the edge of the world.
Welcome back to Dreamland. I'm your monthly guest host, Kelly Chase. Today, I'm bringing you a conversation with the brilliant UFO researcher, historian, author, and beloved member of UAP Media UK, Graeme Rendall. Graeme is the author of several books focused on historical UFO cases from the 1940s and 1950s, including UFOs Before Roswell, European Foo-Fighters 1940 to 1945, and Chasing Shadows, Aerial UFO Encounters 1955 to 1956. Graeme has earned wide acclaim within the UFO community for his meticulous research and attention to detail in bringing forward historical cases from the dawn of the modern UFO era. I have all of his books on my shelf, and they are invaluable reference guides that I return to again and again. I really can't recommend them enough. I really enjoyed this conversation with Graeme, and I'm thrilled to be able to share it with all of you. So without further ado, here is my conversation with Graeme Rendall. Graeme, it's so wonderful to see you. Welcome to the show.
Hello, Kelly. It's about 18 months since we bumped into each other, so it's good to see you again.
Yes, absolutely. It's all of our UK friends. We don't get to see each other as much as we'd like, but well, it's wonderful to see you. And, you know, I wanted to just start off kind of asking about how it is that you got interested in the UFO topic.
Oh, it goes back a long way. As you can see, I'm an old man. So I'm nearly pushing 60. I'm a few years off 60 year old. So I've been in this game quite a long time. Maybe not as necessary as an active researcher or an active commentator, etc., but somebody who's definitely been interested in the topic since a really early age. So you're going back to maybe when I was about 8 or 9 years old. So yeah, you know, well over kind of, I think it's now sort of just getting on for 50 years or just short of that nearly. And really, it was being interested in science fiction novels, and I was reading those at a very early age, even earlier than 8 or 9. And they always have these lovely covers to entice the reader to, you know, to pick them off the shelves in the bookshop and buy them. And there were always nice pictures of spacecraft. And my mother, God bless her, thought she was doing me a favor by buying me another book as a present. And she gave me this book one day, and it turned out to be Mysterious Visitors by Brinsley and Poe Trench, who was a fairly famous UK UFO author back in the 1960s and early 1970s. So I got this book, and it was, you know, it's one of those ones where it did actually blow my mind. I know that's a kind of well-used saying, but actually it's true. It was the kind of concepts, the ideas in the book. It was effectively science fiction, but fact. And, you know, being a sponge back then, I just wanted to know everything about everything. And this really kind of galvanized my curiosity in so much as I wanted to learn a lot more about the subject. Because, yes, okay, you can see these things flying around on the screen, you know, the small screen or the large screen in terms of fiction. But when it's supposed to be happening in real life, that's something much, much different. And it was just really, really fascinating. So yeah, I just went on from there.
That's so fascinating. Something that I enjoy so much about your work is that you really do go right to the source and try to figure out like what was actually happening at the time, kind of peeling back the lore and really looking at the facts themselves. Could you talk a little bit about how you got into the research that you do and kind of what your approach is when you're writing your books?
Yeah, I think like a lot of people, you look at stuff, and whether it's your research or anything else in life, and you have a few brain cells sort of think, I wonder if I could do that, maybe not better, but certainly differently. And I just remember reading the kind of books back in the 70s. And even at an early age, I was really curious to know where the information came from. And you never got that kind of, you know, detail in the books. And if you did, then there were magazines or books, which I'd never heard of back then. A lot of the American publications back in the 50s and 60s, like True, Look magazine, they were just words on the page to me. I had no concept of what these kind of sources were, let alone the other UFO books that were quoted quite a lot as sources, or the researchers who were quoted as sources, and some of the witnesses. You know, these were just things I was learning about. But as I got a bit older and I started to get a bit more into, you know, how books are written and how books are actually, you know, the information sources attributed, all the rest of it, then I started realizing that actually a lot of the kind of UFO books I was reading back then had very little of this to go on. They were essentially looking at the reader and going, you have to trust me on this, you know, take what I'm saying at face value without backing up what they were saying. And if they did include it, it was just a list of footnotes at the back. But it was very sparse. It was never a complete list, not like you might have in a scientific publication where you have to, you know, go to the nth degree to back up everything you were writing. So I thought, you know, when it came my turn to be able to actually start planning something into writing something, I thought, you know, I'm going to throw the kitchen sink at this. Not only am I going to actually go and put down every source that I'm using so people can effectively check my homework, but I want to go to the nth degree in terms of like trying turning over stones. So you just follow a story backwards. So if you have a source or you have a tale or a sighting, you just basically, you know, go back through that and try and find whether the origins of that story, of the sighting, of that piece of information in a newspaper, where that comes from. And then see where that leads you to, because obviously that's not necessarily the end of the beginning of the story either. So it's just a case of, as you say, peeling back these layers. And sometimes it actually tells a different story entirely, because it can be down to the nature of the person who's telling the story in the first place. Maybe they're not credible, or maybe they are credible, or maybe, you know, they've got a completely different angle to it and it's not actually what's being said. So there's all these different things that you have to factor in when you're looking at evidence. And it's just really interesting in itself, you know, never mind actually putting the words down on the page for somebody to read at the end of the day. It's just that kind of journey where you're going through all information and finding out bits. And then that takes you down you'll like this word, these words, rabbit hole, depending on your background. And, you know, it does take you down sometimes they're blind alleys, but other times they're really useful sources of information. So yeah, it's really interesting. And for me, it's just so enjoyable that even if nobody bought the books, I would still do it.
That's awesome. And I'm so glad. I think what you do is so valuable. When I was starting out with my own research, I was really shocked to find when I would do like what you're talking about, where someone would be speaking with such authority on something and I'd say, oh my gosh, could this possibly be true? And then it seemed like a lot of the times when I would follow the kind of paper trail back, I would find that these things, you know, originated somewhere like some message board and on the internet in the early 90s, but there's like nothing predating that. And so it's really hard to sort that out. Like, how often do you find that's the case where like you trace something back and you're like, gosh, I really actually can't confirm this in any way that makes me comfortable?
It's a lot of times, you know, you have to be able to be prepared to deal with frustration in this. If you're going to be a researcher, you're going to go down blind alleys more often than not. You're going to bang your head off a brick wall because you can't find that little bit of information that makes you, you know, sort of happy enough to actually accept that, you know, the source of information has been true, verifiable, all the rest of it, has been kosher. A lot of the times it's down to good instinct, you know, so it's whether you trust what you're reading or what you're, you know, discovering as being, is it halfway fact or is it just somebody making something up? Because we all know about stuff that on social media nowadays, that if you repeat it long and hard enough, and someone's loud enough, or if the right people say it, then, you know, many more people will accept it as fact, even though it's nothing of the kind. But then it becomes fact, or fact with the collars around it, becomes a, you know, this kind of urban myth. But actually, sometimes it's really difficult to separate the myths from fact. But if you go far enough back, and you do uncover all these stones, then what you do usually get back to the actual, that, you know, that truth, that kind of kernel of truth where it all springs from. And from that, you can usually have a good idea in your own head about how kind of true it is and whether it is somebody just making something up. And actually, the research I've done for a lot of my books, I've come across things where you get to that point and you think, no, that is not right. Now, some people might bury that because they know it doesn't fit in with the overall narrative in so much as, you know, there's something mysterious out there that we're not sure about. And you can tell in the past that people have actually buried things because they're not comfortable, you know, highlighting things that deviate away from that road, that path, if you like. And they kind of shed, you know, a poor light on ufology. Whereas to me, you know, a truth's a truth. Doesn't matter whether, you know, it advances ufology or whether it's something that we have to actually highlight because it's wrong And then we can, you know, move on from that and concentrate on other things which deserve more attention. So I'm not afraid of highlighting things or drawing attention to things where, you know, I found something that actually casts, you know, sort of a bit of doubt on a story, because actually I think I'm doing people a favor, and I'd like other people to do the same if they come across that kind of thing, because there's no sense in perpetuating myths. It doesn't do anybody any good at all.
Absolutely. I think I see it in the community so much. I think I wasn't around before 2017, but I get the impression even more so since 2017, because it seems like we've gotten this kind of shred of credibility that the community never really had before, and that people are so protective of it. And there's this sense that, like, if we almost like if certain stories don't hold up, that somehow the whole thing is going to fall apart. But I agree with you. We need to identify those things. And I think we only build credibility with people outside of the community by being willing to say, like, oh yeah, we were wrong about that one, like that, and here's why. Mm. And so, you know, I give you a lot of credit for doing that. Can you give an example of, like, let's maybe use your Foo Fighters book as an example. Okay. What kind of sources do you look for that you can, that to help you kind of establish these cases? And what gives you clues that, you know, a certain story is more credible or more reliable than another one?
Well, I think if to determine whether it's reliable, you have to look at the squadron records of the official intelligence reports from the time, because even though they're not necessarily 100% accurate, because of obviously as the war went on, some of the theories and some of the stuff that appeared in these reports turned out to be nothing of the kind. So, you know, they were sort of theorizing about certain types of German weapons early on, and it turned out the Germans weren't doing any such thing, or they were doing different things. So you have to take, just have a little bit of a kind of weather eye in things that you read. But actually, you know, when you do read enough of these reports and they talk about all these strange lights and weird shapes in the sky, etc., it forms a pattern. So they are quite reliable sources of information for the period. They're effectively the equivalent of, you know, the kind of Project Blue Book reports. Because in terms of level of detail, because you don't get a huge amount, you know, beyond just what's in the mission report. But if you put it all together, then it does tell a story, as my Foo Fighters book does sort of like try to lay out. So there actually is quite a lot of that detail. It's just a question of finding it, Kelly. You know, it's not quite easy. It's not as simple as just going to an internet search engine or an archive search engine and just typing the word UFO in, because you won't find anything. Obviously, that phrase wasn't around in the wartime years. So you have to actually delve a bit deeper. You also have to be a bit creative with the kind of searches that you do. And usually involve physical searches. A lot of this stuff isn't actually digitized. So it involves maybe a trip down to London for me, to the National Archives. Now I can actually request stuff in advance, and I have a fair idea where some of these reports may well be. So it's narrowing down that kind of initial inquiry, getting them to like pick out 20 files, which is usually the daily limit, that I can look through. And when I'm there, I can, request another three, I think it is, using a computer system. And usually the search terms along the line of your sort of anti-aircraft, weapons, reports, that kind of stuff. They used to have observers used to fly with the bombers and actually do quite detailed reports on what the German anti-aircraft defenses were like. Now, sometimes strange things appear in those reports. So that's the kind of an example of the kind of, you know, search that you have to do. You have to, like, you know, put in those kind of parameters rather than saying, I'm looking for flying saucers or I'm looking for UFOs, because you simply won't find it, as I say. So, yeah, you have to be a bit more discerning and a bit more devious even. in the way that you actually do this. So that's how I approach kind of trying to find stuff from the wartime reports. Similarly, with US Air Force's Historic Records Agency at Maxwell Air Force Base in Alabama, I think it is. It's a simple thing. It's a similar thing there, sorry, that, you know, their search engine, it's not very easy to use, unfortunately. But once you get the hang of it, again, you have to be creative with the search terms. So you have to go into the kind of FLAC reports, as they call them, or the the operational research section, and they're the ones that used to do all the various analysis of things during the war, during bombing raids. you know, from navigation to radio to anything really, and strange things they saw in the sky. So there's a kind of, there's some reports in there as well. So again, it's, you know, just trying to work out where these things might lie in terms of sort of strange sightings, you know, how the pilots and air crew would actually report them. Where would these reports likely to, you know, where would they likely end up? And once you find them, then it's a question of just going, okay, are there any more similar types of reports? You know, maybe just under a slightly different heading or for a different year or a different squadron, blah, blah, blah. And that's how you dig out the others. Now, in terms of the Foo Fighters book I wrote, some people back in the 90s and in the decades since had actually gone through some of the squadron reports, the American night fighter squadrons, for instance, in the European theater of operations. And they had found the ones which are fairly well known. But in terms of a lot of the Royal Air Force squadron histories, nobody looked through them. They were still buried in the archives. Very few people had actually looked through them, even to verify the stories, the handful of stories which were already known from the British side of things. So that was, again, that was something else which was fairly easy for me to do. Obviously, I've got my other hat on as a kind of aviation historian. So it makes it easier for me because I have an idea of where you find things, depending on what you're looking for. So if you're looking for aircrew names or, you know, details about a certain bombing raid, et cetera, I know exactly where to find those in the National Archives. So that makes it easier. And where those details lie, that's sometimes where you get, you know, information on strange lights that they see passing their aircraft or torpedo-shaped objects and things like that, which are reported. So yeah, there are ways and means to find it. It's not straightforward, but it's definitely doable.
I'm really struck when you're talking with just how Google has crippled us in some ways, because people do have this feeling that if it's that everything's Googleable, and it's so clear that with certain things, that's just simply not the case. How long does it take you to write one of these books with all, you know, the research and you have like extensive footnotes? Like how long does it take?
Funny enough, the Foo Fighters book took 7 months to write, and I was spending pretty much every waking hour writing it. So, and actually, for the first 5 months, I was still actually doing a full-time job. I was still working for our health service. So, and I took early retirement after, you know, 2 months before the book came out. So I was writing on it pretty much every spare hour I had, and even through the night sometimes when I got my teeth into a particular kind of set of unit records where I thought this is too good to stop now. You know, it's 11 o'clock at night. I want to keep going. And yeah, I get a shout through from my wife maybe at 1:30 in the morning. You're not going to bed yet. sort of thing. It was just like, you're still up. So yeah, I was a bit like a dog with a bone kind of thing. I just won't let go. I just keep plugging away. But I think and I already had quite a lot of information anyway that I hadn't actually written down or I had, but I hadn't put into a kind of coherent form. So it was a bit easier to put that together, funnily enough, even though it's quite a long book, it's 550 pages. And then the last third of it is an analysis of stuff which I was already aware of. So that was easy to write in terms of German secret weapons and the stuff that's been put forward as a, you know, possible causes for the Foo Fighters, in terms of stuff that came out of the neo-Nazi side of things, or people who are trying to write books and make money from the subject. Which was easy to knock down in terms of, yeah, I know why these things, you know, these stories exist, et cetera. And I know where the sources of this information comes from. So that part of the book was quite easy and very quick to write, for me. Whereas the pilot and aircrew, ones that I started writing afterwards. So I take, you know, a couple of years, sometimes 3 years at a time, and write about all the aerial cases, over those periods. They've taken a little bit longer, because I've had to effectively start from scratch with those, if you like. And I've had a dive into, you know, various sources of information from those. So whether it's, you know, the Blue Book brooch or sign reports, or a multitude of other places where you get this information from. And then have the fact check as well. And then also dig into these individual cases to see whether there's anything else to them, which may not be sort of, you know, I might not initially aware of. Yeah, it can take a long time. It can take a year sometimes, sometimes even more. Sometimes I have things on the back burner. And I'll get, not sick of them, but I'll get to the point where I'll think, right, I really want to write something else at the moment. It's not boring me writing this, but I've got, you know, in some ways it's not writer's block. You just get a bit kind of like, I want to move on to something else and I want to do something else. And I know I can get that done quicker. So yeah, there have been things. And the one I'm thinking about off the top of my head here is the equivalent book from the Foo Fighters for the Pacific War. That's taken an absolute age to actually go through various information for. I'm finding it hard actually to try and get information from the Pacific side of things during the war. It's possibly because I haven't got that much experience of actually researching or even knowing about a lot of the battles or some of the stuff that happened in the Pacific War during the Second World War. It's never something I was entirely 100% interested in back, you know, when I was reading about World War II when I was a kid and all this kind of thing and afterwards. So I don't have such a comprehensive knowledge of that. So I'm going to have to, you know, sort of bone up on that before I can go back to writing that book. But in the meantime, I've got plenty to occupy myself.
I can imagine. Well, we're going to take a quick commercial break and we'll be right back. Hi, everyone. This is Kelly Chase. I'm Dreamland's new monthly guest host. You can catch me here on the last Friday of every month. If you're interested in checking out my other work, you can find that on my podcast, The UFO Rabbit Hole. On that show, I share my own personal research with deep dives into everything from historical cases to philosophical frameworks, as well as in-depth interviews with top thinkers in the field, like Jeffrey Kripal, Diana Walsh-Pasulka, Bernardo Kastrup, James Madden, and of course, Dreamland's own Whitley Strieber. You can find the UFO Rabbit Hole on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, YouTube, or wherever else you listen to podcasts. Just search for the UFO Rabbit Hole. And if you like what you hear and you want to go even further down the rabbit hole with me, I'd like to invite you to join my Patreon community. Patrons get perks like early access to new content and ad-free episodes. I host twice monthly patron-only Zoom calls where you can ask me questions, share your own thoughts, and connect with others. We also have a lively and active private Discord server where members host book clubs, happy hours, and just share their thoughts on all things anomalous without all the drama that's all too common on social media. It's a warm, open-minded, and vibrant community, and we'd love to have you join us. Memberships start at just $5 a month. You can sign up at patreon.com/UFO rabbit hole. That's patreon.com/UFO rabbit hole. So I'm actually really impressed to hear that you wrote the Foo Fighters book in 7 months. I would have thought it would have taken you at least twice that long. I know for many people in the field, myself included, you kind of reach this point where you almost feel possessed by a certain piece of work. Like it just kind of consumes you and it feels like it almost comes through you. And I was wondering, you know, if that's something that you identify with, because you really must have been, if you were working full time and did that in 7 months, like I feel like it really must have sort of been something of an obsession for you. Is that something you identify with?
I think it is, yes. And I think also it gets to the point where you can almost quote, you know, word for word, certain paragraphs that you've written. It gets that deep in terms of how, you know, so how comfortable, how familiar you are with what you're writing about, not just the words that you're putting down, but the cases that you're writing about, the names involved, you know, the types of airplanes, even just the different arguments that you're using throughout the book, all the rest of it. You can just reel it off the top of your head. And some people have commented on, you know, my kind of recall for some of this stuff in the past. And I guess that is the kind of product of, you know, living with, you know, breathing it, you're writing it, you know, kind of 24/7 almost. Now, when I wasn't at home writing it, I was thinking when I was at work, sometimes for a spare second or two, you know, or in my dinner break or whatever, I was like thinking in my head, oh, what have I got to look at now? Or maybe looking at stuff on my phone, thinking, right, oh yeah, that's where I've got to like, you know, concentrate on next. Or I was planning out the next part of the book on my phone. In notes and stuff. So, you know, even if I wasn't at home, I was still sort of thinking about the book. So it was almost a case that you didn't switch off. And I'd wake up in the middle of the night and I would have like an inspiration, or I'd be thinking, oh, I've missed something, or, you know, oh, I have to go and expand on that, or, you know, et cetera, et cetera. And I would have to get up and write a few notes or switch the computer on and go and type a few things in, you know? So it got quite, all consuming. I think that's quite a perfect description. And is it healthy? Well, I guess if you do it like too often, it probably isn't, but 7 months, I seem to survive it at least. And I think I've sort of learned a bit from that, in so much as you have to dial it down a bit. It's not so healthy. You do have to have a release. You have to have other things you can do just to take your mind away from something, you know, just even for a short period of time, so you can reset You know, you reset yourself, reset your batteries, you can recharge yourself, and you can then throw yourself back into it with a renewed vigor. So yeah, it's not probably healthy to actually just be this kind of all-consuming thing that you just, you know, takes up your entire life. You don't have a family, you don't have a life outside it, you know, but you have something to show at the end of the day, I guess. I wouldn't necessarily recommend it to people looking back. But then again, it was my first major work. I had written books before, but it was the first major work. And obviously, you know, maybe just the amount of time that I put into it, it obviously came down to the page, hopefully. It certainly had some decent reviews, so I can't complain. I guess the difference between that and the other books also, if I'm brutally honest, is that I don't have 100% recall of the others because I haven't had that kind of full immersion. Whereas I do know a lot of the stuff I've put in the books, you know, don't get me wrong, but I don't have that kind of, I can't quote chapter and verse for everything where I feel I can from the Fruit House book because I didn't live it. And, you know, I lived it, I slept it, I ate it, you know, you name it. Whereas the other books I learned just to slow it down a bit. So I think maybe that kind of, you know, osmosis that you get when you're writing something and everything just transfer into your brain. I don't have that anymore. And obviously as I write more books, there's only so much room in my head for everything. So I think something has to give occasionally. So if somebody, if let's say for argument's sake, you asked me something today about, Flying Saucer Fever, the book, that Lou Elizondo wrote the forward for, and you asked me to comment on a particular stuff, on page 300, let's say, I wouldn't be able to tell you off the top of my head. I would have to go and especially if it was a more obscure one, I would have to go and have a look and go, oh yeah, no way I get this. I got this from, you know, et cetera, et cetera. There's only so much room in my head.
I really resonate though with the feeling of the obsession not always being healthy. There was a journalist who I was speaking with recently who's kind of newer to the field. And he basically kind of is reaching that stage of like ultimate ontological shock and just,
yeah,
you know, all of the things that happen. And he kind of put his head in his hands at one point and was just like, I need you to strongman for me the argument that I shouldn't just walk away from UFOs forever and never think about this ever again. And I just laughed and I was like, I can't make that argument for anyone. Like, if you can walk away, like, maybe you should. Like, I don't feel like I can, but, like, I can't necessarily recommend this level of obsession to anyone
don't you feel, Kelly, that there's so much information out there, even just, like, what's on X or Twitter? Yeah, I'm old school, I call it Twitter still. But don't you feel that you read through everything on there in a day, or if you catch up with everything that's been put down, you're never going to have enough time to read through everything, like line by line, or anything that's referred to, like another website or a magazine article or a newspaper. You're only ever just scratching the surface of what's out there. So you can't devote yourself full time, as much as you might think you do or you might like to. There's just too much out there nowadays with social media and with everything else that's going on. I find that I can't keep up with everything. Does that make me want to walk away? No, it doesn't. It just makes me more selective, I guess. So I'm quite selective in who I listen to and the kind of podcasts that I'll listen to as well and the people who I trust, etc. But that doesn't mean to say I can't, you know, become abreast of everything that's happening. I can't get into the minutiae a lot of the time. I have to sometimes just look at the surface stuff. And then if something's a bit more, sort of interesting or appealing, then I'll go, okay, well, I'll spend 10 minutes having a look through that, or having a listen to that or whatever. But I find that I can't, you know, devote myself 24/7 to it because it's just not healthy. But then again, it's the realization I just don't have the time. Not that I can get in the way of writing the books. I just aren't physically enough hours in the day to look at everything and quiz everything and think about it all and talk to other people about it. It's just not possible. So you can only do what you can do. And if, you know, your friend, the journalist, has that kind of realization that, you know, you just have to make allowances for the fact that you're never going to keep on top of it. You can only sort of look at a certain amount of stuff and still try and make sense of it. Then that's the best you can do. And really, you know, once you come to that realization that, yeah, you can't see everything, you can't read it all. And actually that's quite healthy. Rather than trying to race around, trying to look at everything and trying to keep on top of everything, it's not possible. If anybody says that they do, I think they're telling fibs.
No, I agree completely. I was just down back in March, down at the Archives of the Impossible, filming the docuseries I'm working on. And I had this really humbling moment where I was sitting there and, you know, there's six boxes of the communion letters. And even that is just overwhelming. And they're handwritten, and they have drawings of, like, the people sketch what they saw. And just to get through those six books, I mean, through those six boxes, and to absorb them and to understand them would take an incredible amount of time. Yeah. And then you have sitting off to the side these 75 boxes of, you know, the Mac files that it's going to take them years to even get through and make them available to people because of people's personal medical information and that sort of thing. But I was just sitting there thinking, I feel pretty comfortable saying that I know more about this. I'm easily in the top 1% of people in the world in terms of, like, my knowledge on this subject. And yet when I think about how long it would take for me to just understand those 75 boxes of the Mac files, you realize how insane it is and how much there is and how no one person can ever really get there. And I wonder, like, I'm sure you have that sense of humility too. And, like, how do you respond when you see people kind of act with such, like, certitude about certain things and, like, be so certain of certain things and, like, be willing to, like, really fight with other people? Like, what is that like for you as someone who kind of has a sense of the scale of the information that's out there?
I've seen it across, you know, not just ufology. I've seen it across aviation topics, aviation history. Back in the day, you were talking about bulletin boards before, or internet message forums. I remember the days of the old Newsnet message, you know, bulletin boards back in the 90s, and they were a hotbed of people arguing. It was the first time I'd really seen people going toe to toe, you know, kind of like having real kind of full scale fights over whether this was right or that was right, et cetera, et cetera. You know, it's really strange. So, you know, the things that happen on social media nowadays, the kind of spats and arguments, they're nothing new to me. You know, I've seen all this kind of thing before. Sometimes it's just the intensity and the kind of, you know, the veracity that involved. That's quite, it can get quite strange or quite nasty. But, you know, I have seen this kind of thing. So it's nothing new for me. And I've experienced it myself back in the day as well. So, you know, I wasn't quite part of the fight, but I did get into it. Kind of like, you know, sort of, you know, saying, well, that's not right. And, you know, you have to go and type something and say, you know, I think you might want to, like, look at your sources kind of stuff. And then you get flamed, as they used to call it back then. They had a vocabulary back then as well. But you had trolls and all the rest of it. So, you know, it's a kind of circular thing. It comes around again. So, yeah, it's just weird. I look at some of these people and I just think, okay, yes, I'm not sure where you're coming from on this. Because you're saying things which you can't back up, or nobody can back up, but you're then, you know, advocating it's real. And then there's other people who I really respect and who have done the kind of, you know, their due diligence, and they have unearthed information to prove what they're saying is correct. So again, you have to be just discerning. Now, a lot of the time it depends on what your internal narrative is, what you believe yourself, you know, what you think is the, you know, the background to everything. Or where you think truth lies. And you're always going to lean towards people who say similar things. It's just the way people work, how people's minds work. But you still, you know, I'd like to think people are still you're able to question, you know, even if somebody comes along and says something you definitely want to hear, then you should be, you're still able to go, yeah, okay, I want to make sure that you're telling the truth, though. Where are you getting your information from? You're questioning that, you're checking out where they're getting their information from, et cetera, et cetera. So I don't blindly follow people. I try to, you know, do as much as I can to have a look and say, well, you know, okay, I'll look at what they've said before, or I'll maybe watch a few things that they've been in, or read a book or two that they might have written, or magazine articles, or just, you know, things they've posted on the internet, to get a sense of who they are, to get a sense of what they're saying, and also to see, you know, whether their information seems right or not. Now, in the end of the day, sometimes it comes down to a gut instinct, because you can't do a lot, you know, of that kind of checking to work out whether somebody's telling the truth or not. And it does come down to, does it sound right, you know, sort of thing. And quite a lot of the time, I just end up going, I don't know. I'm not afraid to say those three words. I've often said that. And in case of, okay, what you're saying just sounds like a great story, but that's how it's going to end. You know, until you can go a bit beyond that and you can prove it and you can throw a bit more out there to actually, you know, back up what you're saying, it's just going to remain an interesting story. I'm not going to say you're lying because I can't do that because I can't disprove what you said. Equally, I can't necessarily take it at face value either. So it'll sit somewhere in between those two viewpoints. So yeah, and that's how it ends. So there's a lot of people out there who have made claims in the past who that's where they sit. They're just stories, as far as I'm concerned. There might be interesting stories. There might be intriguing stories. They might be really kind of potentially earth-shattering stories, but they're still stories. Whereas there's other people who, the kind of people, folks will know who I mean here, that have come forward and have said things and they've been able to back up what they've said with stuff as well. So there's the people who next time they say something, I'm more likely to lean towards saying, yeah, okay, I don't need to go back and check where that's come from. You know, I trust them more.
Absolutely. So something that really strikes me when I'm reading your work, and also anyone who's really doing work where they're kind of just laying out cases as they happened, with kind of the most, the purest data, we'll say, the kind of most close to the source data, is how different these accounts end up being than kind of what people come to expect from the more popular narrative around UFOs. And I was wondering if you could speak to that a little bit, like having gone through all of these cases, how do you maybe see the UFO phenomenon a little bit differently than is usually kind of in the popular conversation?
I think people were so certain back in the 70s that there was, you know, they had definite ideas about what was happening. And they had their own narratives. Now, they didn't all align these narratives, whether it was, you know, people communing with space brothers, or it was down to, you know, all being abducted and being experimented on, or anything else that you may care to mention. It all seemed that people had, you were writing a book and then they were putting forward this idea and then they were basically using the cases to kind of reinforce that narrative. So everybody had their own story to tell. And they didn't necessarily align. And I think sometimes the people who were trying to make them align were kind of like sort of dancing on the head of a pin to try and get that to happen. And then every so often, some, you know, new bit of information would come along, which would basically cast doubt on what they were saying or what they were trying to push forward. And then you would see the kind of pivot that would do as well, which was sometimes interesting to watch, but it wasn't a gratifying experience because, you know, a lot of people would believe what they were writing. So it left me kind of very, very wary about sort of saying what I believe is happening because I go back to, I don't know. You know, you might have an idea and you might have something in your head and think, well, okay, that might be true and that might not be true. But actually, I just don't know because there are so many different things that happen. And when you read enough about what's happened in the past, you know, let's say, for instance, look at the shapes of UFOs over history. If there were one uniform, roughly uniform shape, let's say for argument's sake, a diamond, if they, you know, from the get-go, from historical records, I'm going back to say the 17th, 18th century, if people were seeing them back then, they were diamond shape. If they were seeing them in the airship scare of the 1890s, they were diamond-shaped. If they were seeing them in World War II and they were diamond-shaped, if Ken Arnold had seen diamond-shaped UFOs, then at least we could have an idea that this is what the kind of scale in the phenomenon represented. It's a diamond-shaped craft, and then you could go on from there. But they're not. They're all different shapes. You know, they're spheres. They're disc-shaped. You know, they're cigar-shaped. Well, that's another word for tic-tac, isn't it? You know, sometimes they are globes, sometimes they are diamonds. You know, there's no kind of hard and fast rule for what these things seem to be. And then you've got the other sides of the phenomenon. So you have the, the abductions, you have the experiences, you have underground bases, allegedly, you have all these different angles. And, you know, I defy people to put it all together because there's just so many different strands. I don't think we can. You know, I haven't seen anybody, you know, satisfactorily put it all together yet. And then the ones who try to, they have these enormous leaps of logic between one thing and another. And it just leaves me scratching my head. So this might sound like a cop out, but I'm more quite happy just to sit back and let others have a go at it because, you know, knock yourself out if you want to try and put all these bits together, because, you know, I haven't got the time and I simply don't have whatever, you know, is up in upstairs in my brain to be able to go through it all and go, I can make sense of all this. And people have tried over the decades, but I don't see anybody's actually come up with a coherent kind of narrative to fit across everything that seems to have happened and is being reported. And I think that's quite telling, actually, in a way, because it just means that the phenomena is not just more kind of like, you know, sort of possible to imagine, but it's more possible than we can imagine, maybe. It's just every time you think you've got a kind of like a grasp of a small portion of it, something else comes along and it makes you just go, what? And then you have to reevaluate everything that you've read, everything that you've thought about it. It just gets to the point where I don't know. If people want to think that, I haven't done my homework, or I don't know what I'm talking about, or I just think I'm copping out for the whole thing, then fair enough. I don't care at this point. I'm old enough and more experienced enough now to think that I've spent getting up for 50 years reading and looking at this kind of and trying to think it all out, and I'm no further forward, really. So that's where I sit at the moment, I'm afraid.
I completely agree. I find that I tend to trust more the people who say, I don't know, because I feel like if you have a real answer, you just haven't dug deep enough yet.
But the easiest thing in the world for me, it would be the easiest thing in the world for me to come out and give a theory about something. But really, heart and heart, I know it's probably wrong, you know, and why should I like try and push a narrative to somebody who's reading a book to say, this is what I think these things are? Because actually, something might come along, you know, another bit of information might come along tomorrow, or I might find something as well. And then I've got to go and reevaluate, you know, revisit all that. And I've got to write, well, sorry, but I told you a load of nonsense here. You know? And you see people changing a story or changing a kind of narrative that they put forward because, you know, more facts emerge, or another story emerges, or somebody else has a bit more of the puzzle. And then you can see them having to, you know, sort of rapidly kind of change what they've said in the past, or, oh, I didn't mean to say that, or really this fits in this way. And you see them dancing about trying to fit this next bit of information in. And it's, I just can't go. I couldn't do that. I would fail miserably at it. And two, you'd spend more time doing all that than actually trying to research UFOs in the first place. So it's just not worth it, I'm afraid.
So true. Well, we're going to take a quick commercial break and we'll be right back.
Who are they? Why are they here? What do they want with us? Why is it all so secret? All of these questions are explored in my new book, Them, in an entirely new way. What do Close Encounter reports tell us about what the visitors want with us? What is the military's experience? And can our memories be trusted? Can anything be trusted? Them answers all of these questions in a totally new way. It's available in hardcover, softcover, as a Kindle, and as an audiobook, read by me. Get Them today, and you can get it from the unknowncountry.com store, signed by me.
So, Graeme, since you are such sort of an encyclopedia of cases, would you mind sharing with us maybe, you know, one of your favorite cases, or, you know, one that's always kind of stuck with you that you find really fascinating?
Yeah, okay. I'm going to go back to Foo-Fighters because I've got instant recall on so much from that book. And it's actually the cover. The cover is, people keep saying to me, is that real, or is that just something that, you know, was dreamt up for the cover of the book? And I keep going back to them saying, no, it's in terms of real in so much as it's a real case. We've got March 1942. We have an RAF bomber flying back from a raid on Germany. So a raid on Essen, which is in the industrial heart of the Ruhr. And this is a Wellington bomber. So it has two engines. It has gun turrets at either end, so the nose and the tail. It has a crew of five. And the tail gunner, where they're flying over Holland, goes on the intercom saying, we've got something coming up behind us, to the pilot. And the pilot says, if it gets close enough, then open fire on it. Now, this thing was an orange disc. It wasn't an airplane. It wasn't anything recognizable. when the gunner opened up, and you could see the tracer bullets, so that's 1 in 10 bullets. They're kind of fluorescent rounds, so you can see where you're firing at night. The bullets went into this disc and nothing happened. Absolutely nothing. So if that had been a German night fighter, it would have been, you know, set on fire, or it might have exploded, or at least it would have dived away damaged if that kind of weight of fire had hit it. But as far as the gunner was aware, these bullets were just going into it. They're also being, I guess, absorbed by this object, this disc. And after a little while of this fruitless firing at it, the disc then moved around to the side of the aeroplane as it was flying through the skies at about 180, 200 miles an hour. And it sat off its wingtip. And by that point, both the tail gunner and the nose gunner, who was actually the navigator, the radio operator, he could actually fill both roles. He was also the nose gunner. They both turned their turrets to fire at this thing off the wingtip, because that could be done. The turrets could actually move far enough around to be able to do that. And it was some distance off the wingtip, and they were both firing at it. And again, nothing happened. It then moved around to the nose of the airplane and sat off the nose of the bomber as it was flying through the skies. And it effectively maintained station at this certain distance. And the nose turret gunner had turned his turret again, and he was opening fire at this thing, because obviously they were trying to shoot it down, whatever it was. And again, they probably did think it was something German, some kind of German secret weapon they'd never come across before, because it was there. It was bright orange. It was sitting there. It was absorbing the bullets. Sorry, but it's nothing could seem to do that. And then after a while, it just shot off into the sky at 45 degrees and vanished from sight. Now, that would have been, you know, kind of story that maybe nobody believed on the ground when they landed, and they were talking to the intelligence officer from the squadron at their home base, because they would always get debriefed after a raid. And it was usually along the lines of, you know, did you drop bombs on target on time? Did you see anything unusual? Were the German black defenses kind of, you know, effective? All this kind of stuff. And that's when they would have told this story. Now, normally the intelligence officers would actually laugh off stuff like that. They would come along the line and something, you know, you've been drinking, that kind of thing. But actually the pilot of the aircraft in the bomber stream behind this Polish crew had also said, we saw that thing. They had a kind of a similar kind of view of it, of this orange disc. It's this crazy story. Now, the strange thing is, it doesn't actually appear in the squadron records for that particular month. And I know which raid it is, but the Polish pilot, he emigrated to Canada after the war, and he came out in about 1962 and gave the story to a Canadian researcher, and it ended up in Flying Saucer Review, which is a UK magazine from back then. It's appeared in a few books, but it's a very, very little known case, and possibly before it appeared in the Foo Fighters book that I wrote, very few people, I guess, certainly on Twitter, that, you know, in terms of my readership, would have ever come across it before, because yes, it's very hard to find.
That's such a fascinating case. I know that there's like a certain contingent of people who believe that the Germans did, whether it was by reverse engineering, recovered technology, or some other means, that they did have this kind of like advanced technology that could potentially explain the Foo Fighters. What are your thoughts on that idea? Like, do you think this could have potentially been German technology, or is that just like out of the question?
There's two strands to the kind of German technology question. So there's an indigenous question. So did they develop their own technology, which looks like kind of flying discs? And then there's also the bit that you've mentioned there about, you know, reverse technology of things that might have acquired somehow, either by crashes just before World War II, or possibly even during it. Or if you believe some of the stories, contact with beings from Aldebaran. So you can see where this is going. Some of it's quite fanciful. And I guess, like a lot of things, you just trace these kind of stories back to their origin. So you dig in to the kind of lore around this and just go as far back as you can to find out who initially made these claims. Now, in terms of, I'll start with the indigenous stuff first. So homegrown possible flying saucers, German flying saucers from the war. If you go far enough back, you can find where those stories come from. And it's a group of people, no more than two or three, who make these kind of claims in German newspapers and German magazines in about 1950, 1951, and 1952, and a couple of years afterwards. those stories effectively formed the basis of some information that appeared in a book of about German secret weapons in 1957. And then effectively it became fact after that, if you like. And it was built upon by neo-Nazis in the 60s and also in the 70s. There are some fairly famous neo-Nazi authors from those times who not only kind of perpetuated the kind of myth, if you like, about that, but they also wrote novels about it. And the information in the novels ended up becoming fact in terms of sort of German bases and Antarctica and this kind of stuff. So there's a lot of, you know, you can see where all this information comes from. But now, if you look hard enough, or you don't have to look that hard, actually, on the internet, you'll see this stuff being, you know, put forward as being truth. But actually, if you go far enough back, you'll find that it's nothing of the kind. And that kind of truth, you know, you have to back it up with facts. You have to back it up with documentation. You have to back it up with eyewitness reports. There's actually very little of any of that. In fact, the documentation is not. And what actually is put forward as being documentation is badly photocopied. It's fairly crude. It's stuff that, you know, you can knock together yourself. You can fake. It's very flimsy, and there's very little or no eyewitness accounts. The stuff that is around is stuff that you can't back up anyway. So it's very difficult to actually try and sort of, you know, put it forward as a credible source of information. Equally, it's very difficult to knock it down, because it's so entrenched now on the internet and elsewhere. And, you know, you find books on it all over the place as well. It just seems that people go, yeah, it's true. And they don't do much digging into it. In terms of, and the similar kind of thing's true, I guess, on the other side of things. So whether the Germans reverse, you know, engineered stuff that they might have come across. The story's out there, but when you trace them back, you don't really get very far. There's rumors of a crash. Vehicle is in some description in Poland or Silesia in, you know, 38 or 39, I forget exactly when. And that was the basis, allegedly, of some of the reports of them doing this. But then, of course, now we have the story of the thing that crashed in Italy in 1933, or was recovered in Italy in 33. And then there's now a kind of a story built up around that. And I don't know is the answer to that one. I've got some kind of like, sort of thoughts that it might not be entirely true, but I'd like to see a bit more independent kind of examination of the documentation that purports to be, you know, the kind of origin of this, those telegrams, etc. It's been done already by somebody who I think was quite kind of sympathetic to the story that's been pushed. Now, you know, you really do want to have independent experts looking at this kind of stuff, and I hope that gets done at some stage. And I hope more information comes out. Unfortunately, the kind of source of this is anonymous as well, because the researchers who all this material is passed to, you know, nobody knows who they are. So you're getting into kind of MJ-12 territory, where you have like, you know, documents which may or may not be true, and there's a high kind of, you know, sort of suspicion that they're not, or pushed under doorway, you know, under doors in the middle of the night kind of thing to people. All this kind of stuff. And I think when it's done that way, you know, it does kind of sow seeds of doubt in people's mind. Whereas it was kind of upfront, and somebody had just come and said, look, I found these and I can tell you where they're from. Here's my name, et cetera, et cetera. I'd be more inclined to believe them rather than some anonymous source. And so I have my doubts. They're not, I'm not going to go as far as to say that it's all wrong and people are lying. I wouldn't do that. I just have doubts. And then some of the other information that's around this, which I pointed out on another podcast in the past, the stories, some of the details where they talk about Italian Air Force fighter airplanes traveling at certain speeds to try and catch the things that were sighted around them at the same time over Italy. And they talk about the speeds involved. Well, and they can't catch them because they can't go any quicker. Well, actually, Italian fighter aircraft at that time were capable of much faster speeds. So yeah, have these kind of story, and some of the details don't quite don't match up or don't sound true. So when you hear that, you just think, okay, well, what else isn't quite right here? So it just sort of puts questions in your mind, it just puts doubts there. So nice stories again, like a lot of stuff, but very, very lacking in detail, I'm afraid, until I get to that point and I see stuff that makes me think, okay, yeah, you know, you've got some, you know, nice documentation there. And I can read through that, and that looks about right. Then they're just stories. similar go, same things go to, you know, all the stuff about the bell, you know, the Glocker, all the kind of, well, it comes from one source again, anonymous people who passed information to a Polish author. Again, you know, you have to question these kind of sources. And I guess, you know, you or other people who are known in this field would be intelligent enough and resourceful enough to be able to make up a story like that with evidence light, but something that actually sounds quite plausible. You could make up anonymous sources, put a story together, make it fairly coherent, make it effectively watertight in terms of stuff that you can't prove, so you can't get anywhere with it. Equally, you can't dismiss it, and it would sound amazing. You know, and I'm sure, you know, either we could do it individually or we could put our heads together as a collective, some of us, and we could come out with stuff like that if we wanted to. But there's the difference. You know, I would never do that. But, you know, and I just wonder sometimes, are people trying to sell us, you know, some a bill of goods here? Some of them just don't sound right.
Yeah. And I think that's so important. And it's such a good example of how complex this gets. Because, you know, with the Italian case that you're referencing, you know, this is something that David Grush has referred to. And so then there seems to be this kind of rush to paper that up and to say, and to say that everything he's saying is correct, because the implication being that, like, if he was wrong about that case, that, you know, maybe he's lying about everything or he's wrong about everything. And I think people really underestimate the extent to which the whole field has been kind of sullied with disinformation, and that even our high-level intelligence officers aren't immune to, you know, this information, this bad information that's been kind of mixed in with the good information.
I think when you go back to David Grush, I mean, yeah, and it's not a case of, this is not a criticism of him either, because someone might come along and say, oh, well, because you think that's wrong, maybe you're questioning him as a source. Well, I'm not, because intelligence officers with the best will in the world, they're dependent on their sources as well. And if somebody who's credible comes along with something that, again, they're picking up from somewhere and they're being told is correct, then, you know, naturally you're gonna think something's, you know, sort of, has got much more weight to it. I go back to actually to Nick Cook's Hunt for Zero Point book. And I don't know if you've read that, but I know a lot of people have. And in that book, he mentions the legend. And it's from this, well, he doesn't actually, he uses a pseudonym for this this person that he worked with, a former colleague. And this colleague tells him about this legend. And it's supposed to be like a timeline of events in terms of, you know, UFOs, et cetera, and discoveries, et cetera. And part of it is possibly to do with stuff before the war, and also things that the Germans were working on as well. So you can see from that, if somebody's going to be really clever back in the day, maybe they have set up some kind of narrative that, you know, has enough to it to make people intrigued, enough documentation that makes parts of it credible, enough eyewitness testimony and other bits and pieces associated with it, that the people can look at it on the surface and go, that actually is right, because, you know, here's X lines up with Y, lines up with Z, all this kind of stuff. And then it's put forward as, yeah, this is the history. We're just trying to add to it with all these other bits, you know, that we find out. And then it's passed down from person to person. And then when, you know, you get somebody else, like maybe a new group, like the UAP task force gets set up, let's say, for argument's sake, somebody will come along as a source and go, here you go, you're the legend, you know? And then you've got all this baggage associated with it, which may or may not be true. And I just think that, and I go back to this hunt for, you know, Nick's Hunt for Zero Point book, and this source of his was saying about the legend. And I just have to question myself sometimes and just think, how much it actually is true? You see it crop up in other places as well. You'll see in Donald Kehoe's The Flying Saucers Are Real, his book, he has an intelligence source there who feeds him information, and he questions himself as to whether some of it is effectively plant. Not necessarily to him, but also to his source as well. You know, he questions whether he believes it or whether, you know, it's just being pushed down to try and push him away from certain levels of inquiry. So, yeah, you know, who knows what's happening, where some of this original information, where it comes from, and whether it's just tacked on to more believable bits and maybe true information. And then it's all bundled up as to, well, this is all kosher. And actually, no, some of it's a bit kind of, you know, a bit dodgy. And I mean, it's designed to send us off in the wrong direction. It's sometimes designed to discredit us because eventually this might come out as being completely hoaxed or completely false. And then, you know, it, not surprisingly, someone will come forward and question David Grush or question Lou Elizondo or question me, question you, you know, all this kind of stuff. But that's only because one tiny bit or one fraction of this overall story, this overall narrative, this overall group of information is wrong. But that doesn't mean it's everything else is. But it does tarnish it. It does tarnish the speaker. It tarnishes the source. So you have to be very careful. And just don't take things on face value.
Such excellent points. Well, and this feels like the perfect place for us to wrap up the free portion of the show. For any paid members of Dreamland, I'm going to be continuing on for about another half hour with Graeme. As he's mentioned, Lou Elizondo wrote a foreword for his book. Lou is someone that he's gotten to spend some time with. And so in the last portion of this interview, we'll be talking about his thoughts on Lou Elizondo and disclosure and so forth and so on. So I hope you'll join us over there. And for everyone who's leaving us, it was wonderful spending time with you, and we'll see you soon.
Bye.
Have you ever read Communion? Or have you never read Communion? It's out in a new edition. Very powerful, a subtly new cover that reflects the fact that the visitors are now looking back at us because they truly are. You can get it from the unknowncountry.com store as a Kindle, as a beautiful, sumptuous paperback, or as an unabridged audiobook read by me. It's the first time in the whole life of Communion that it has been read in full in audio format. And believe you me, I felt that reading. I put my life, my memories into it. And I trust you can hear it in the voice. I sure felt it while I was reading. So get Communion, listen to it, read it. Communion is of central importance to all of our lives.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by unknowncountry.com and its family of subscribers. Our theme music is The O of Pleasure by Ray Lynch. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host. And I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander.